This is Thursday, August 13th, 2015. We are in Natick, Massachusetts, and this tape is part of the Morse Institute Library's continuing Veterans Oral History Project. My name is Maureen Sullivan. Our cameraman is Dan McDermott of Natick Pegasus, and we are privileged to have with us today Harry Westcott. Welcome, Harry.
Thank you.
May I ask when you were born?
September 14th, 1924.
And where were you born?
Providence, Rhode Island.
And where did you spend your childhood?
Warwick, Rhode Island.
What community do you currently live?
Wellesley.
Your marital status?
Married.
Do you have children?
I have four.
Grandchildren?
Six.
Great-grandchildren?
Six.
And tell us what Warwick, Rhode Island was like growing up.
It was semi-rural and semi-residential. A lot of it was bedroom town for Providence, and a lot of it was truck farms, meaning vegetables and produce.
And what did your parents do for a living?
My dad was an engineer with the Narragansett Electric Company, a part of New England Power Company, and my mother was a school teacher.
And did you have any siblings?
Nope.
And did you go to school?
I did eventually. Okay. My mother had a private school that she established. She called it the Westcott School, logically. And there were four of us, a boy who had lost an eye, a girl who was a severe type 1 diabetic, a girl whose mother was an itinerant salesman and father was, and I. And she taught the four of us from kindergarten through the sixth grade.
And then you went to?
Then I went to Aldrich Junior Senior High School in the seventh grade.
You were about 14 years old, 13, 14, when the great hurricane of 38 paid a visit to Rhode Island.
Yeah, it sure was.
Tell us what that was like.
It was, of course, totally unexpected. The weather forecasts had made no mention of it whatsoever. And when it started to blow, it became very, very dark because the wind blew. We had a garage with the old-fashioned garage doors that opened like a book. And they blew off, went flying down the street. Then the roof blew off. And my mother says, I think this is going to be severe. And so I was going to go out and secure something that might be left of the garage, and there was no way. I didn't want to let go of the back porch post because I was afraid I'd blow away. And the trees went down and the fences rolled up and rolled away. It was wild.
And you told me before the interview you were part of a Boy Scout troop.
Yeah, Troop 1 Gaspe Plateau. And we went out down to what they called Gaspe Point, which had been a summer colony. All little shoddy cottages built along the sand because they largely blew away or collapsed or were buried in sand and sea. And we went down to look for whatever. Mm-hmm. It was unnerving for a kid.
Search and recovery.
Yeah.
So you're now going to public school.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Were you made aware of events happening in Europe and Asia at that time?
Oh, yes. Oh, sure. We were aware of it. My family was very much news-oriented, listening to the radio. We'd have to sit down in any late afternoon and early evening and listen to the news. My father was adamant, you must listen to the news, know what's going on.
Did he or you have a favorite broadcaster for the news? You remember any of the broadcasters?
No, not particularly. Edward R. Murrow, of course, mm-hmm. Way back when.
Do you remember what you were doing when you heard about Hitler invading Poland in September 1939?
I was on the cusp of getting my driver's license. And that's because 1940, I became 16. And all I could think of was, I'm going to get my license. And when I heard that Germany invaded Poland, I thought, oh no, is this going to keep me from getting my driver's license? This is a really serious matter.
And so you now you're in high school. What high school are you going to?
Aldrich. Nelson W. Aldrich Junior Senior High School, Warwick, Rhode Island. Nelson W. Aldrich was a senator from Rhode Island at one time.
All righty. And you remember what you were doing the day Pearl Harbor was attacked?
Yes. We had gone to visit my grandparents, and oddly, for some reason I don't know, we didn't know about it. But then I went to a church youth organization that evening, and everybody was talking about it. And I felt as if I had been left behind the door for a few minutes until finally they brought me up to speed.
So the United States has declared war, and did family or friends enter the military right after?
Oh yes, yeah, quite a few of my friends, some of whom found it very propitious to join the service rather than hang on in high school because they might have been having some difficulties.
And when did you join?
August 1943.
And what branch?
Army of the United States, as distinguished from U.S. Army.
Okay.
U.S. Army were regulars. We draftees were Army of the United States.
Oh, you were drafted.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You got that little letter from Uncle Sam.
Yeah, yeah. We want you.
Mm-hmm. And so 1943, you would have been 18.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. August, yeah.
Month from turning 19, you got the letter. Where were you, where did you sign? I mean, what office did you go to?
Well, of course I was in Warwick, Rhode Island. Mm-hmm. It was a little town called Appanog. That's where the draft board met. That's where we reported. And the, just a brief aside, I had spent the summer before I went in with the Appalachian Mountain Club working in the White Mountains. So, as a result, I was fit. I'd been packing loads from this road level to the Appalachian Mountain huts up in the above tree line in some cases. And so when I went to basic training, I was fit.
Oh, the sergeant must have loved you. And where did you report for basic?
We were inducted in Fort Benning, Georgia, and then went to, inducted in Fort Devens, mm-hmm. In Massachusetts, and then quickly transported to Fort Benning, Georgia.
Was this your, aside from the Appalachian Mountain Club, was this your first trip to that part of the country, Fort Benning?
Oh yes, I'd never been south at all. Dogs and soldiers stay off the lawn.
Tell me what basic was like.
It was very much like a game of capture the flag in Boy Scouts. We get up in the morning and we'd drill and we'd march and we'd hit endless lectures about disassembling and assembling the rifle and tactical maneuvers, and then we go out and run them. It was sandy, pitch pines, sand fleas. Oh, it was hot, and it was kind of fun in a way.
Did you receive any advanced training?
Yes, in a way. A number of us were assigned to the Army Specialized Training Program, and they singled us out. They were going to make engineers out of us. So they sent us to colleges all over the United States. I was fortunate enough to land in Cornell, mm-hmm. far above Cayuga's waters.
When were you sent to Cornell?
In the fall of 43, 13 weeks after I had gone in the service.
And how long did you stay at Cornell?
That was a sad thing. One semester. At the end of the semester, they decided, we can't spare all these people going to school. We need them for cannon fodder. So they pulled us out and assigned us to infantry divisions. And I was always incredulous that they would, we who they had singled out as, quote, the brightest and the best, I know that's fatuous, and sent us to college. And then he pulled us out and put us in infantry units. Well, there's nothing wrong with being an infantryman. But still, it seems as if some of us could have found something more productive to do.
And what division or infantry unit were you assigned to?
Company I.
Company I.
The 3rd Battalion, 289th Regiment, 75th Division.
At what rank?
When I went in as a private, and then I became PFC, Private First Class.
And did you have any special duties?
Yes. One of the fortunate things is I had been a bugler in Boy Scouts. And when I went in the service, we went to Louisiana for maneuvers after college. And the first sergeant said, "Is anybody here a bugler?" And of course, the rule is never volunteer. Anybody have a truck driver, and you end up pushing a wheelbarrow. And so I kept quiet, but I had my mouthpiece with me. But in order to keep my lip up, I would tootle on the mouthpiece. And he heard me. And he came and he says, "Westcott, you're a bugler." I said, "I'm a trumpet player, cornetist." He says, let me hear you blow a bugle. And he produced one.
Of course.
So as a result, as we were in final training in Camp Breckenridge, Kentucky, being a bugler, I blew the calls in the morning, reveille, and mess call, then duty call, and then for 3 or 4 hours, I was at liberty. I didn't have anything particular to do. Didn't hang around the company headquarters because sergeant would find something for me to do that I maybe not like. So I enrolled voluntarily in a communication school. And I already knew Morse code from Boy Scouts. And I already knew a little about radios because I made little Dickey radios when I was a kid. And so it prospered me. And as a result, I became a guy that carried the radio around on my back. And I was assigned to company headquarters to accompany the lieutenant, who was the executive officer of the company, to keep him in contact with battalion headquarters. So I knew what was going on. I was one of the few people in the company that really understood what was happening. Most of the people, you do this and go there, but I knew why. Mm-hmm.
So you knew before everything became scuttlebutt.
I was the one that started the scuttlebutt.
Aha. All right, after Camp Breckenridge, you're now the guy who carries the radio. Tell us what happened next.
We went to staging area in New York and then got on the boat. His Majesty's ship Franconia, a leaky old tub, rusty thing that the
you
British...
And
there's like 15,000 of us on this one boat. And then we had a rough ride over to England. And we disembarked from the ship and stood on the dock and watched it sink. Because when they shut off the engines at the dock, the pumps stopped. And the water was no longer being expelled from the ship. And so we you look at the ship, it's almost like a lock when you watch the ships go down in a lock.
I was about to say, you didn't get to go on the Queen Mary.
No.
The rusty, leaky Franconia, which sank the minute you got off. So I was about to ask also, were you in a convoy? Was the Franconia?
Oh, yes, yeah. Okay, oh, convoy. Yeah. It was fun to stand on deck and try to read the code, because the shutters on the floodlights, searchlights, were opened and shut according to Morse code. And I thought, wow, I would be able to read it. But it was random collections of numbers and letters, like 5-6-3-A-2-B, but which meant, I don't know, the captain wants a bottle of rum, I don't know, some.
What part of England did you land?
When we landed in Liverpool, and immediately were whisked to Wales.
And what was Wales like?
We were in a fascinating little town east of Cardiff, way out on the western peninsula of Wales, called Penclod. And it was a tiny shell fishing village. I always remember the sound of, at low tide, the ladies would go out with two-wheeled carts into the mudflats and dig cockle shells and put them in a screen to sift them, shaking the screen back and forth. And I always remember the sound of ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch.
And what were you doing down in Wales?
Running up and down hills. They were getting us ready.
Oh, well, you were the guy with the radio. What were you getting ready for?
Well, of course, we knew we were going to land in France, but it was way too late for us to hit the beaches, Omaha and all that. So when we went over, it was, for us, compared to what those guys went through when they landed under fire, ours was a piece of cake.
And when did you land in France?
Near Le Havre.
Near Le Havre, and when?
Oh, when? I think it was December, it was the first part of December.
Okay. 1944?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Way after the landing in June.
Tell us what happened next.
They put us on trucks and took us to a funny little muddy farming village of Fréville in France and said, make yourself comfortable, we'll let you know what's going to come next. But there wasn't anything comfort because it was raining and muddy. Have you been out west and seen a feedlot? That's what it looked like. We stayed there for 2 or 3 days, and then they put us on 40 and 8s, a freight car that holds 8 horses and 40 men. Huit hommes, 40 chevaux. And took us on into right near Belgium.
It's December 44, you're near Belgium. Are we about to hit the Battle of the Bulge?
The Battle of the Bulge was just bulging.
Uh-huh.
And what we had originally been intended was to drive the Germans back across the Rhine. But the Germans had developed this capability, if you will call it, and they wanted to push on and see if they could hit the coast of the English Channel and push everybody off. But so all of a sudden, the commanders realized that Germans here, Germans there, Germans everywhere. Where'd they, whoa, where'd they all come from? So they threw us in there and said, stop them. And there were any number of divisions of them, there'd been 20 divisions that were in that maw of the Battle of the Bulge. many of the times we didn't know where we were at. Anecdote, where in a section of woods, forest, combination forest and farming, and here comes an American tank toward us. Out of this, behind them were six German Tiger tanks, which are 1.5 times the size of an American Sherman tank. And we said, this does not bode well.
Let's keep you in the Bulge for a minute. And what was your equipment like?
Awful.
Awful?
Awful. We were in snow and cold. It was one of the coldest winters they'd had in 100 years, they said. And cold by that token was like 20 degrees, 15 to 20 degrees at night, and not enough to thaw in the daytime. And we had leather combat boots, wool, olive drab clothing, and an olive drab clothed soldier in the snow is like a merganser duck sitting in a pond. The Germans had white coveralls. Mm-hmm. We were not allowed to take the coveralls off the German bodies and wear them because international law said you can't wear the enemy's uniform.
And yet the Germans did, didn't they?
But the Germans wore our uniforms. Mm-hmm. And that was alarming.
Mm. And what did you have to eat in the field?
C rations and K rations. K rations is a cardboard box covered with wax in which there was a little can of some spicy meat, a few crackers, piece of candy, three cigarettes, and the C rations were a can about the size of a tomato can, in which was many of them corned beef hash. We'd put them on, we'd punch a hole in them, put them on the manifold of the Jeep, and let the Jeep heat them up, because you couldn't build a fire. Mm-hmm. Build a fire, you invite disaster. It was misery.
So, and you were the guy with the radio still?
I was the guy with the radio. Westcott this, Westcott that, Westcott the other thing. Mm-hmm. And the radio, sad to say, this was a radio this wide, this high, this thick, weighed about 20 pounds, I guess. You can go to Best Buy and buy, for $39.95, you can get a pair of walkie-talkies that will reach infinitely farther, much clearer, and of course way lighter than the big clumsy radio I had, which had tubes in it. Can you imagine carrying a tube radio? I had a little packet wrapped in all kinds of fluff with extra tubes, and the only way I knew which tube had gone was to take them all out and replace them one at a time. And they were very vulnerable. Mm-hmm.
And speaking of vulnerable, I mean, you had to be right next to the lieutenant, was that correct?
Yes, yes. Lieutenant and I were too close.
Were you being shot at?
Oh yeah, that was very uncomfortable. We had many a case where we were pinned down. We couldn't do much about anything because we were there, and mortar shells are coming in, sniper fire going. Never know whether we're going to be counterattacked. The lieutenant was trying to find out, should we attack or should we move to the side? Should we make a strategic withdrawal or whatever? Other aspect of my job was stringing wire to platoons. A company is stationed at some propitious spot and then fanned out anywhere from a few hundred yards to even a quarter or half a mile out in front, and they're spread along the line to protect the particular area. And you couldn't communicate with them by radio, because of course that would divulge everything we're doing. So we had telephones, they were called sound-powered telephones, and the wire was on metal reels. So two of us would put a stick through the middle of the reel, grab one end of the stick, and run as long as we could until we got fired on. Then we'd flop down and wait until things calmed down a little, and then we'd get up and run some more until we reached out to where the platoons were. And then that hookup enabled the platoon to be able to respond to commander's wishes at the direction. It was a weird situation by today's standards.
Mm-hmm. Were you still a PFC at the time?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
So you're like at 19, maybe 20 years old at the time, and you're getting fired up. What were you thinking at that time?
What am I doing here? It was kind of weird. Each event had transcendental importance. So you concentrated on what you had to do at the moment and tried to disregard the aspect of the whole in its entirety. So you concentrated on the parts, because that was all you knew. We had no idea what we were doing. Maybe once every two or three weeks we'd get a copy of the Stars and Stripes newspaper, and we say, oh, that's what we've been doing. You can't see the trees for the woods, mm-hmm. and the woods for the trees. And the Ardennes forests were largely coniferous trees, and much of it had been planted, so the trees were in rows. So it made it very difficult to travel across the rows, because the Germans had the rows all laid out for their machine gun fire. Mm-hmm. So you try to flit from row to row to row, and chances are you get fired on.
Mm-hmm. In addition to the radio you had strapped to your back, did you carry any weapons?
Oh yeah, I carried a carbine, M1 carbine. Fortunately, I didn't have to carry the big, heavy, 9-pound M1 rifle. I didn't have to fire the carbine.
Well, you had a chance to see a lot of the German weaponry up close and personal. What did you think of that?
They had superior firepower. They had a machine gun we call the burp gun. It was when it fired. And it was far more effective than our Browning automatic rifle, which fired bang, 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 bang. Nothing like the M16s they have nowadays. Mm-hmm. But also the Germans had 88 artillery shells. They were devastating. Because they would detonate at tree level. Mm-hmm. So instead of a detonation being on the ground and go up in an inverted cone, they'd detonate at tree level, and then the cone would envelop all of us underneath with shrapnel.
So after going through this for a couple of weeks, first clear day shows up, and I hope you're seeing American flyers coming overhead.
Those vapor trails were the most beautiful sight you ever saw in your life. Christmas Eve, we were fired on and very badly, and the best Christmas present I ever had was seeing those vapor trails mm-hmm. on Christmas morning.
Because that meant that supplies were coming through, especially petrol.
It wasn't the petrol so much; it was the bomb out, mm-hmm. so that they could bring pressure to bear on the German troops that were trying to filter in on us. Mm-hmm. They wouldn't stop, though. The Germans were relentless, recklessly so. We couldn't imagine that they would be so crazy. Hardly anything stopped them.
I mean, while you were in training, or even before that, what were you being told about German soldiers?
We were being told that they were more like automatons than thinking soldiers. That go there, do that. Nobody ever asked why, or how can we do it better, or isn't some other way this thing can happen. We were told that Germans were so heavily indoctrinated into what they needed to do that nothing could deter them. Well, that was pretty accurate, too. Mm-hmm. Except later on in the Bulge, we began to get German prisoners. They put their hands on top of their head and say, Nick Schießen, don't shoot. I guess they may have realized that the end was near.
Did you ever see any of these guys? The German prisoners, I mean.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. We were issued tags that we write on the tag where they were captured, and they had a big string and they hang them around the German's neck. Mm-hmm. I remember one time a German soldier said to me, as he was loading onto a truck, he says, I'm laughing up my sleeve at you, ho, ho, ho. And I said, why is that? He says, because you're going to sit in a hole in my country and I'm going to your country and live it up. Probably ended up in Stark, New Hampshire.
Could be. So hopefully the Bulge is behind you, but you still have a lot of Germany in front of you. Tell us what happened.
They pulled us out. Mm-hmm. And sent us down to the Alsace-Lorraine, and that was a toughie. Between the city of Cologne and the Rhine River, there was a pocket of German resistance that the French had not been able to dislodge. And so they put us with the French First Army down there, and it was our job to drive the Germans back over the Rhine. And in fact, as a result of that, I ended up 70 years later with a Chevalier of the French Army for an award that they gave to those of us who were in that battle.
French Legion of Honor?
Mm-hmm. Chevalier de Légion d'honneur de France. It was a crazy campaign because there were little towns about a kilometer apart across broad open fields, which in the late winter, early spring were fallow, of course. There were no crops growing on them. And they were muddy. Like the New Hampshire mud season where the ground thaws for 6 or 8 inches and underneath it's frozen and the water doesn't have any place to go, so it makes a soup. And we were advancing across those fields toward these little towns and under fire because here we are out in open fields and then no place to hide. So the tanks in some instances would go out in front of us and provide shelter for us. So we walked behind the tanks as they advanced across the field.
Did the tanks have difficulty with the mud?
I'll say. They had difficulty with the mud, and they also had difficulty with anti-tank guns from the Germans. And when they started to get fired on, they'd get panicky and try to retreat. And of course, their treads didn't grip very well in that mud, and they'd start to sink. And one incident that stuck in my mind forever was a guy was walking right behind the tank, behind the tread on the left side of the tank, and all of a sudden the tank stopped and backed up before he could move. And down he went, and it went right over him. And of course, we're all hollering and banging on the tank with the rifle butts shouting at him. And so the tank commander, what could he do? Go forward? He didn't want to go backwards because there was more of the tread left, and he realized what had happened. So he went forward, and we dug the guy out of the mud, and would you believe he was alive? He was. They went back. He went back across, and I found out months later that he had most of his ribs were broken, and he had pelvic injuries and all. But he lived and survived. He came back from the war and conducted his life. Imagine getting run over by a Sherman tank and live. It was unbelievable.
Once in a lifetime experience that you never want to go through again. All right, you mentioned that your unit was with the French First Army. Did you have or have any direct contact with them?
I did a little bit because of my communications responsibility, but my major contact was with a French, I think he was probably a French Army, but he was dressed like a civilian. And he was a contact person between the French Army and bringing news to us of what the Germans were doing. And I was looking like a French bomber. He didn't come under suspicion. If he'd ever gotten caught by the Germans, he'd been shot right away. He was a very interesting guy. His name was Robert Baffaut.
And did he speak English?
No.
No.
Okay. I spoke high school French with him. Franglais.
We're now in early 45, and we're still around Alsace-Lorraine.
Well, we cleaned that up.
You did clean that up.
Yeah, and then back up north again.
Back up north again.
I mean, we went to Holland for a while and waded through the water the Germans caused by breaking their dikes. And then we went into the Ruhr Valley, Dortmund, Essen, Dusseldorf, big cities. And we had to clear the German out of those venue, and they were tenacious. Many of them were leftover SS officers who for some reason or other had escaped the defeats in the Bulge. And many of them were older guys and very young, very, very young, Edel Jugend types. And they wouldn't accept the fact that the end was coming. By then, the Bulge had been dissolved, Bastogne had been freed, and we were cleaning up. But trying to clean up factory complexes with people hiding everywhere, snipers in every window, it was a very challenging piece of work.
During this time you were cleaning up and trying to dodge sniper fire, were you ever given R&R? Rest and recreation periods?
Yeah. What they call rest and recreation, they pull us back and say, okay, take a break. And we'd strip down and they'd run us through these showers in tractor trailers and come out the other end and give us a whole new set of clean clothes, most of which didn't fit, and send us on our way. And we'd say, oh boy, now we got a chance to get some good chow. And they give us, maybe we get a meal. And then, okay, get ready to move out. And we're ready to go again. And I think the longest we ever got was 3 or 4 days.
And you being the guy with the radio, you did manage to keep up with what else was happening?
Oh yes, it was good to have some idea. Remember, one time we were supposed to take Hill 550, and a new lieutenant who had just come in from the States said, tomorrow morning at 5 a.m. we're going to charge up Hill 550, we're going to knock out the machine gun nests and accomplish our objective. And my communications sergeant and I and two or three others said, Lieutenant, maybe there's a better way to do this. What do you mean? I said, couldn't we go around the back of the hill and in the morning we'll sneak up the back of the hill and hit them in the back of the head? And we won't have to run up in front and get gunned down? Well, okay, we'll think about it. Well, that was when I came in, so I had to contact battalion headquarters and appraise the battalion commanding officer what was happening. And so he put the lieutenant on the implement to use the radio was like a telephone handset. So I handed it to the lieutenant, and he said, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. He says, tonight we're going around back of the hill, and tomorrow morning, yeah, okay.
You've mentioned that you often accompanied the lieutenant, while you were at the radio strapped to you. Did you go through more than one lieutenant?
Oh, yeah. Lieutenants came and went like swinging doors. Mm-hmm. Some of them were 90-day wonders that came out from nowhere. They'd gone to college and gone to an officer training school for 90 days. They sent them to us, and they weren't battle-hardened. They didn't know. It was too bad because some were nice. They were nice boys, but they shouldn't have been there. They should have been trained. Our best lieutenants were those who were battlefield promotions from our platoon sergeants that became lieutenants along the way when the platoon lieutenants were gone, then the platoon sergeant would be promoted to lieutenant. And they were very effective. They were good. My captain, my company commander, was a good guy. The only reunion I went to was the 50th reunion of the division. And so I went up to him and I says, Captain Anderson, you remember me? And he says, yeah, he says, you were the smart aleck kid with the radio. And he didn't use the word aleck, you know.
Let's get you back to somewhere in Germany, 1945. We're heading towards springtime, but you're still meeting resistance?
Yes, yeah. Yes. Finally, it wasn't until the middle of May before the subsistence subsided, and all of a sudden it was over. Oh, it was almost unbelievable, you know.
Do you remember the day when Franklin Delano Roosevelt died?
Yes, but I don't remember the day. I remember we heard it.
It was April 45.
It was probably a day or two later that we heard about it. And because we wonder, what's Truman going to do now? Because we knew that war in Japan was still very much on. And we said, are you going to get involved in that?
Well, let's hold Japan off for a second, and let's get you guys to May of 1945. Germany capitulates. You have this, where were you at the time that happened?
In Westphalia, which is in northeast Germany. Mm-hmm. And we were assigned to a little town called Lüdenscheid in occupation. It was a nice little town. It had 7 hospitals. And it was largely unharmed. Allied bombing had spared it because of the hospitals. So it was a nice town. We lived in a hotel, about five guys to a room. And it was really quite comfortable.
Did you interact with the German populace?
Very little. We were admonished not to. They really didn't want us to. But anecdote, there was a swimming pool that had been badly neglected, of course, during the war. All green and full of algae and gunk. And we cleaned it all up. We got an electrician to fix the electric power part. We got the plumber to fix the filters and got the thing running. We requisitioned chlorine from the commissary and treated the water, and we got it going. Sparkling water looked great. We said, now we can go skinny dipping in our new pool. No, because the pool is a civilian fixture, and you can't go there. You can't. But we got it up and running. Well, weren't you nice? I'm sure the people appreciated it, and they did.
So tell us now about what turned out to be VE Day. In May of 1945, did you guys have a celebration?
Not particularly, no. Uh-huh. No, just a vast sense of relief, uh-huh. of relief and release. All of a sudden, we went immediately under the gun. But then there was always that specter of what next?
So were you still in Germany, or were you about to be shipped to England?
What they did is, after Ludenscheid, they reloaded on trucks mm-hmm. and went to redeployment camps in northeast France. Mine was near a town called Reims, and they were cigarette camps, they called them, because mm-hmm. the camps were all given names like Camp Lucky Strike, Camp Philip Morris, Camp Chesterfield. Cigarette companies were smart, weren't they, huh? They gave us cigarettes, cigarettes in the rations. They gave us cigarettes every time we turned around. And then they named the redeployment camps by cigarette names. And I became an armorer artificer. Isn't that a nice title? My job was to take apart rifles, hundreds of them brought in on trucks, and one by one, take them apart, inspect the parts, cannibalize the ones that weren't operative, and put them, new ones together, and then take them out and test fire them. And if I and three or four other guys would have taken us 600 years to do all the rifles that came in piled up all over the place, it was a futile thing to do.
Well, at the end of hostilities in Europe, what was your rank?
Corporal.
All the way to a corporal?
Yeah. That's
and you're still with the 75th?
Yes, oh yeah, right to the end.
And you might be deployed to Japan.
Ooh, that was scary. Huh? And when Truman dropped the bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, that's when we had the celebration. Whoa! When Hirohito capitulated and said, it's all over, and then they sent on the USS Missouri and signed the treaty, then we were jubilant.
And you were still at the cigarette camp?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Still in France. Mm-hmm. A huge celebration.
Then started to break us up, and I was assigned to be the chief maintenance guy at a hotel in which officers were billeted in Reims, Rolls, as the French called it. And while I was there, a guy came to the door And they said, hey, Westcott, there's a guy here who wants to see you, wants a job. So I went out, and believe it or not, it was Robert Baffon, with whom I had worked in the Alsace-Lorraine and the Colmar pocket. And we had a big hug, and the Frenchman, you know, kissed you on both cheeks. And the other guys all standing around with their eyebrows raised, what's this?
And Robert did get a job.
Yes, I got him a job as a Jeep driver. He's a courier to go from billet to billet to billet, carrying stuff around.
How long were you in France?
I stayed there until, I could have gotten out Christmas of 1945, but things were going well. I was enjoying France, and I was enjoying Robert Baffon and his people, and so I didn't rush home. I had enough points that I could have gotten home. I came home in March of 46.
And where were you discharged?
Fort Devens, Massachusetts. Full circle. Close the loop.
And you got out as a corporal?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And did you receive any medals or commendations?
Well, of course, the Combat Infantry Man badge, naturally. And the European thing with three battle stars, the Ardennes, Alsace-Lorraine, and East Germany. I mean, West Germany. And Bronze Star. Of course, all the usual ones. Good Conduct Medal, because I didn't get busted.
Yeah.
And American Service Ribbon, and Victory in Europe Ribbon. So yeah. I had a couple of rows of ribbons that were quite impressive.
And for what did you receive the Bronze Star?
That was part of the action in Alsace-Lorraine. They didn't award it to me until, I forgot, it was 70 years later anyway, it was in New Hampshire. And I was living in New Hampshire, and Carol Shea Porter, the representative from New Hampshire, in my district, was serving on the Armed Forces Committee. And she turned up a citation that I'd been given. And they hadn't given me the Bronze Star because they didn't have any. And so she said, well, you should have that. So she got it and called me to her office in Manchester, New Hampshire. And two of my kids went. And we had kind of a little tea party.
Well, that's nice.
Yeah, it was.
And then you also got the French Legion of Honor.
Yeah.
And where did you receive that?
In the Boston Club in Providence. I mean, in Boston. It was Lafayette Day.
Of course.
A couple of years ago. And it was all very impressive. I got pictures in the back of my book. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right, let's get you back to March of 1946. You've just been discharged from Fort Devens. Did you go to school afterward?
Yes, I came home and went to Brown University. I started in September of 1946.
GI Bill?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. You think I'm going to Brown University without a GI Bill?
And what was your major?
English Expression.
And what did you do after you graduated?
I went to Rhode Island College, where I could get a teaching certificate. At that time, Brown did not have an education program, that is, to train educators, because it's all education. Mm-hmm. But they do now. They have a good education department now. But I wanted to teach school, and I had to have a teaching certificate. I got it at Rhode Island College, which is a teacher training institution. Mm-hmm. At the time, now it's a liberal arts college. And then I went to school teaching.
And how long were you a school teacher?
well, how do you want to put it? I was a teacher for 3, 4, 5 years, I guess. Then I was a teaching principal for another several years. And then I was a supervising principal. And then I was superintendent of schools.
And where were you a superintendent?
Jamestown, Rhode Island. It's a wholly owned town on Connecticut Island in Narragansett Bay,
mm-hmm.
halfway between Newport and Saunderstown. Beautiful place.
Mm-hmm.
It was a marvelous assignment. I was superintendent of schools, principal of the 600 pupil school, substitute bus driver, lunchroom supervisor, playground supervisor, baseball coach. I did everything but sweep the floor, and sometimes I had to do that.
Multitasker.
Yeah, that was great. It was a wonderful job.
Mm-hmm. Harry, did you join any military service organizations after the war?
Only American Legion.
Legion.
Well, of course, 75th Division Veterans Association,
mm-hmm.
and Veterans of the Battle of the Bulge. They're kind of social organizations.
Mm-hmm. And what do you do these days?
Enjoy life to the fullest.
Wow.
We have a home in Florida. We have a place at the lake in New Hampshire. We have a home here. We're just about to move out of it and
mm-hmm.
go to North Hill and take up a new kind of lifestyle.
Mm-hmm. Now, how long have you been married to Gerd?
Since 2006.
Mm-hmm. And I understand your wife lived in Norway during the German occupation.
Yes, she did. Oh, she lived. Oh, while I suffered in the cold and the snow, she suffered privation of lack of food, lack of clothing, lack of heat, making clothing out of curtains from the window, shoes out of fishkins, trading family goods for food. She tells this heartrending story about her favorite doll, beautiful doll. When you lay it down, the eyes closed, and it was traded for a bag of potatoes.
Well, I hope to get, Project hopes to get Gerd's story down hopefully pretty soon. So, Harry, is there anything else you would like to say, such as how important was it for you to serve in the military?
Extremely important.
Mm-hmm.
I went in as a boy and I came out a man. It made me what I turned out to be. What I would have been, I don't know, but I certainly had a great interest in living it up. And this way I became focused, I had direction, I had ambition to do something worthwhile, and it turned out that way.
Okay. Harry, is there anything else before we wrapped up this interview?
It's been very interesting.
It has been indeed. Harry Westcott, thank you so much for coming in and taking part in the Natick Veterans Oral History Project.
It was my pleasure. It's been wonderful.